Good morning and welcome to Good Shepherd Community Church in Eschol Park, Campbelltown. Good Shepherd is a Bible-believing, Christ-centered, gospel-focused church with the desire to see the life-changing news of Jesus Christ shared with our community, our nation, and the world. Good Shepherd stands on the rock that is Jesus, and at a time when many things are shifting beneath our feet, we set our hope on the Lord, who never changes and is always our firm foundation. Let's pray. Lord God, we gather in your name this morning to worship and adore you. We acknowledge that there is no one holy like you, Lord. You are our rock and our fortress, our salvation and our strength. Bless our time together this morning, and may many hear your word and be drawn to the rock which is Jesus. You are our God. Besides you, there is no other. We pray all this in the name of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
You know, we talk about fear. I'll tell you one time when I experienced a great fear. We had driven past Sejuna, up towards Maralinga, across into West Australia, through the Pilbara, over to Broome, and then up along what's called the Gibb River Road, crossed the King Edward River, which we were the first people to do that year, and then went to go to Mitchell Falls. If you've ever seen the photos of Mitchell Falls, they are beautiful. But to get there, you had to cross the river through... And I was carrying a camera, and I was sure that I could cross that 20 metres easily, but the current was stronger than I thought. And I felt myself going downstream faster than I was going across, and you experience that moment of internal terror. And about 3 or 4 metres from the other side, my feet suddenly hit rock. And I was never more grateful to hit rock underwater than that particular day. Everybody else moved a lot further upstream and crossed, but that was a really scary moment for me. And I guess those sort of things, you know, really, really speak to us. We understand about rock and foundation. The one house that I have lived in that never ever experienced a single problem with dampness under the house or around the house or in the walls was the house that we lived in Stanley Street, pretty much close to Hyde Park, built by the Lowy family. But that house was built on the rock. It was absolutely built. Underneath, part of it was cut out of the rock. And there was never water in it. It was always dry. And it was one of those things where you know that it was good to build on rock. And it's equally a reminder that all those places where the water seeped in and the foundations gave way and everything, that foundation is really something. Well, this morning, I want to just run you through this idea of what goes on with the rock. This is from Genesis 49, and it's the moment where Jacob, just before he dies, is blessing his children. And in this one, with he's blessing Joseph. His bow remained steady. His strong arms stayed limber, because the hand of the mighty one of Jacob, because of the shepherd, the rock of Israel. And we often talk about the Lord as a rock, but it actually became a name. The Lord is the rock, and that also comes through in the next one. This is Deuteronomy. Now, this verse, or this little passage here, is at the point where Moses is going to die. The next chapter actually records Moses' death. So you've had Jacob's, if you like, last words. Here you have Moses' last words. He starts off in the verse before this. I will proclaim the name of the Lord. I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Oh, praise the greatness of our God. And then he goes on. He is the rock. He is the rock. His works are perfect. His ways are just. A faithful God who does no wrong. Upright and just is he. And again, you have that thing there about what is it to be a rock? Part of it is God's faithfulness. You know, Joshua could say to Israel a bit further on down the track, not one of his promises has fallen to the ground. When someone's like that, you've got a rock to work with. We might say even sometimes he's gold, but with today the image that's being used to describe our Lord is rock. He's faithful. In 2 Samuel, this is David's last words. That's recorded. The next thing is David's. Is David's last words, and this is it. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation. He is my stronghold, my refuge, my saviour. The Lord is my rock. In that context, he also has this song of praise right there. It starts in that same chapter. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is flawless. He is a shield for all who take refuge in him. For who is God beside the Lord? And who is the rock except our God? And from that he makes his confession. It is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. And the psalm, that song of praise of David's goes on a little bit, and in verse 47. The Lord lives. Praise be my rock. Exalted be God, the rock, my saviour. He's the God who avenges me, who puts the nations under me, who sets me free from my enemies. You get a hint there already of the Son of David, the rock. And then there is a third section in the very last words of David. The Spirit of the Lord, this is 2 Samuel 23:2, the Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. His word was on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke. The rock of Israel said to me, when one rules over men in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God, he's like the light of the morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning, like the brightness after rain that brings the grass from the earth. Just brilliant. David, one of David's images, obviously, he probably picked it up as the videos we've looked at about the Holy Land, that he picked it up out of all that time that he spent in among the rocks and cliffs and hiding from Saul, that he just, the Lord is my refuge and strength. The Lord is my fortress. Very strong with David. Then you have Psalm 19. And again, we know these words. And it starts off with, the heavens declare the glory of God. But verses we know. And in verse 14, may the words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Now, all I'm doing this morning is reading scripture with you. You understand that? Psalm 40, verse 2, starts with just the verse before it. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned and he heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on a rock and he gave me a firm place to stand. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust. And that sort of begins to bring to us a bit of a challenge about the fact that it's one thing for the Lord to be our rock, but it's another thing for us to deliberately and consciously trust that it will be all right in spite of everything that our eyes see. And I'm sure that every one of you knows what it's like when things are looking really bad, how you begin to feel the wobble in your knees, the spiritual wobble, where you sort of, where is God in this whole process? And is he really for me? And are those promises really to be trusted? But I love the bit about the slimy pit. You know, there's a little truth in there that, again, points to the future. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and the mire, and he set my feet on a rock. David could say that, and David could trust that word because Jesus chose to let himself go into the pit. David always spoke about being saved from the pit. You didn't let me go over the edge. But he could say that because later on, the one he trusted absolutely allowed himself to go over the edge. That's a very, very powerful thing for us to remember. Psalm 61. From the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. You know, David was a rock for Israel. Would you agree with that? David was a rock for Israel. While the king remained a rock, the nation remained steady. But he could say and he could acknowledge that there is a rock greater than I, and that his dependence was on the Lord, his rock. And that's just a simple thing. He goes on to say in those verses as well, my soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I shall never be shaken. I shall never be shaken. Psalm 92. This is about the righteous. So we've moved, if you like, from the Lord and then to David, but now the righteous. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green, proclaiming, the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him. yesterday when we were meeting for the men's study, we talked about that thing of what are examples of decay. You know, the frustration of the creation as it's in bondage to decay. Well, I can find it in me. My brain has started to deteriorate. There's a lot of stuff I know that I can't remember. Do you understand exactly what I mean? We are in this situation where the knees are not what they used to be. The back certainly doesn't respond the way. I can't run anymore, I realise. I'm running on my heels when I'm chasing the grandkids. We start to decay. I've got a lot less hair than I used to have. The eyes have switched badly in the last year or so. This side of the glasses doesn't see as well as it should. We decay. When I look at some of my flabby skin, we decay. But here's the interesting thing, and it's in this text. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green. And it's true. Your brain can deteriorate. Your body can deteriorate. But the older you get, the clearer becomes the fruit. The spirit doesn't deteriorate. The Lord, that never deteriorates. In fact, spirits go stronger and more fruitful and more productive and more joyous. And it's always anchored on the rock. So, Isaiah 26. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord himself is the rock eternal. Now, if you want to know anything about Isaiah is a prophet who is constantly in battle with Israel and its kings over where they put their trust. Faith in Isaiah is trusting what the Lord says and trusting the Lord's actions and trusting in his presence. So here in Isaiah, trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord himself is the rock eternal. He's not the rock for the first part of your life. He's the rock for your whole life. He's not the rock for only that group of people, he's the rock for everybody. It's not the rock for a period, he's the rock forever. The Lord is the rock. Can't go away from it. Isaiah 51. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness and who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were cut and to the quarry from which you were hewn. You know, we live, and you know, and we're all part of it, we live in a culture that seeks meaning from all sorts of different places. But the one place where we find the real stability and meaning and purpose and significance and value and everything else about our lives is with the Lord himself. You never find it anywhere else. We search frantically for it. We live in a culture that by and large has said what we believe is rubbish. But it still remains that he's the rock from whom we are cut, and it's from him that we get our meaning. Then, of course, you get Matthew. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had no foundation on the rock. Now, we know that text. You need to hear that text. It's in the beginning. It's like chapter 7 of Matthew's gospel. But that statement of his about these words of mine applies to the whole gospel. At the very end of the gospel, where Jesus gives them that instruction, go and make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. Not some of it. And he doesn't say teach them. He says teach them to observe all that I've commanded you. Everything in the new covenant is built on the word. And everything of that word is about Jesus Christ. And it's his healings. It's his reaching out to lepers. It's his compassion on the crowds. It's his confrontations with the Pharisees and the other people who want to put great burdens on people. It's his suffering. It's his death. It's his resurrection. It's his ascension. That's the word, and it's a living word. And when we build our lives on the living word, then nothing can ever shake the house. It can never be taken away from us. And of course, Paul has that wonderful insight in Corinthians 10. Where it's a warning to the Corinthians who are wanting to add all their own little bits to the faith and their own stuff. And he says this, they were all baptized. This is the people in the wilderness. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Yeah. We think of rock as rock, and you understand that, but there is the rock of God as we know him in Christ. And that rock is the source of all our provision. You don't usually associate rock and water. You don't usually associate rock and food. But in that text, Paul says to them, the rock of God was never away from you. It's always with you everywhere you went. The rock was there, and that rock was Christ. And that brings us to today's text, which I simply want to read. Isaiah 44, 6 to 10, but it's actually 6 to 8. This is what the Lord says. Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty, I am the first and the last. Apart from me, there is no God. Who says this? Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty, I am the first and the last. Apart from me, there is no God. Who then is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and lay out before me what has happened since I established my ancient people and what is yet to come. Yes, let them foretell what will come. Do not tremble. Do not be afraid. Did I not proclaim this and foretell it long ago? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? No, there is no other rock. I know not one. There is no other rock. There is no other rock. There is no other rock. I could say it to you 50 times. There is no other rock. But what I love about this text, and it's what drew me to the text this week in the first place, is the third line. I am the first and the last. Apart from me, there is no God. And who says that in the last book of the Bible? Jesus stands and says, I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, but now I am alive, and I have the keys of death and the realm of the dead. Jesus is the rock. And as somebody said in something, I don't even know where I found it, all of that, what I've shared with you, is captured in the first verse of a hymn we know famously. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Cleanse me from its guilt and power. Let's pray. Father, we pray. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is our rock. Jesus is the rock of the ages for all people. He's the rock eternal. There is no other rock. Thank you that you have caused us to be drawn into that rock, that he is our foundation, he's our life, he's the meaning of our life, he's our hope, he's our future, he's our fortress, he's our redeemer. Thank you that the first and the last is for us. And as we take this truth and live it out during the week, and as we speak it in places where there is no hope for people, we pray that Jesus Christ may be established as Lord of more and more hearts. In his name we pray. Amen.
Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flow be a sin the double cure. Save me from the tears forever flow. All for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling.
Let us together affirm our faith by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Have you ever felt like you are in a pit and you just can't get out of it? I think we've all been there at some time in our life. One minute we're building our lives into what we want them to be, and suddenly the ground shifts, the earth opens up, and we find ourselves in a pit that seems impossible to get out of. Pits come in all shapes and sizes. Pits of despair, pits of abuse, pits of adultery, pits of shame, pits of failure, pits of domestic violence, pits of selfishness, pits of self-pity. We wonder at times if we're ever going to be able to climb out of the pit that we've fallen into or stepped into willingly or unknowingly, or maybe even pushed into. If you've ever been in a pit, you'll know that it's hard work to get back out. We hear lots of advice on how to get out of the pit, but we just seem to keep sliding back down the muddy walls to the bottom. Everyone's good with their advice, but what we need is someone to help us to get out of that pit. It reminds me of a parable of sorts about a pit. You might have heard it, and it goes like this. A man fell into a pit one day and couldn't get himself out. A subjective person came along and said, "I feel for you down in that pit." An objective person came along and said, "It's logical that someone would have fallen into that pit." A Pharisee said, "Only bad people fall into pits." Confucius said, "If you would have listened to me, you would never have fallen into that pit." Buddha said, "Your pit is only a state of mind." A realist said, "Now that's a pit." The county inspector said, "Did you have a permit to dig that pit?" A professor gave him a lecture on the elementary principles of the pit. A self-pitying person said, "You haven't seen anything until you've seen my pit." An optimist said, "Things could be worse." A pessimist said, "Things are going to get worse." But Jesus saw the man in the pit, took him by the hand, and lifted him out. If you want to escape your pit, try doing what King David in the Old Testament did. Listen to his words in Psalm 40. "I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him." Many will try to tell you how to get out of your pit, but there is only one who can lift you out of it, and that is Jesus. Have you turned to him and cried out as David did? He will hear you. I invite you to pray with me if you would like to. Lord Jesus, hear our cry. We are sorry that we always try to do things our own way and sort out our own problems instead of turning to you. We fail to trust that you love us and have a plan for our lives. Please forgive us. Teach us to follow you more closely, Lord, to turn to you for guidance and the help that only you can give. We thank you that you died for us and went down into the pit of hell to pay the price that we couldn't. Help us to remember that you are never far from us. We want to be faithful. We want to cling to you and never let you go. But we know that the reality is that it is you who holds fast to us. Thank you, Lord, for your undeserved grace and mercy that you lavish on us. Amen. Whatever your pit is, wherever you are in life, turn to the Lord. He's waiting to hear your cry so that he can answer and just reach out to you and lift you up. He says in his word that he will never leave you nor forsake you.
Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, you'll never let me go. Closest friend, I will worship you until the very end. Jesus, the lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. Set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, you'll never let me go. My Savior, my closest friend. you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, you'll never let me go.
This is what the Lord our Redeemer says. I am the first and I am the last. There is no God but me. So do not fear, do not be afraid. You know it to be true. I alone am God, the rock in whom you trust. Go in the peace and confidence that Jesus, the rock, goes with you. Amen.